Hello everyone, I'm Nicolas Trevisan, also known as Coolcat VFX. What you're going to watch right now is an exclusive preview of the third chapter of the Obelisk course. This chapter is all about shaders and learning how to craft your own in Unreal Engine 5. This first preview video you're going to watch right now is a recap on all UVs work and the theory behind the shader feature called UV distortion. A second preview video, soon to be released on the channel, will show you through a practical exercise how to create said shader feature to animate a static flame. If you're interested in this course, it's accessible on P2 Design Academy, and you can seize a special 25% discount during the Black Friday event, ending on December 3rd. With that said, enjoy the rest of the video. UVs, also known as texture coordinates, play a vital role in 3D meshes and are extensively utilized in shaders to apply textures to these meshes. Essentially, UVs represent a 2D coordinate system that maps points on a 3D mesh surface to corresponding positions on a 2D texture. This mapping, usually made in a 3D modeling software like Blender, enables the application of textures, colors, and other visual attributes onto the surface of the mesh in a specific way. An analogy to understand this concept better would be to think of how Santa Claus chocolates are wrapped in aluminium foil. It's hard to not get angry just thinking about it. What do we need to know as VFX artists when it comes to UVs? First thing first, to access and edit UVs in our shaders, we use the texture coordinate node. When observing the preview window of the texture coordinate node, you will notice the characteristic red and green UV gradient. The use of gradients is to indicate the value range of default UV coordinates, going from 0, black, to 1, white, in both the U and V directions. But why does a UV gradient look that way? This color choice arises from treating U and V as color channels, with red representing the first channel and green representing the second one. The overlying gradients result in the iconic green, red, and yellow UV gradient. By isolating each channel of a default texture coordinate node, we obtain a mathematically accurate gray gradient, a horizontal gradient along the U axis, and a vertical gradient along the V axis. That will be pretty useful later in the course, especially to make simple opacity gradient without having to call another texture for it. So, as mentioned previously, typically, we use UVs of a mesh to determine how a texture is displayed on the associated 3D mesh itself. However, UVs are not limited to texture display alone. We can utilize UV coordinates to achieve various effects, such as making a texture scroll across a mesh, or creating intricate effects like surface deformation through vertex displacement, a technique that we will use for the water shader task later in this course. Now that you have grasped the basics of UVs, let's experiment with them through a new shader. I'll see you in the next video for that. Bye! Welcome back! In our previous video, we discussed UVs to develop a basic understanding of what they are and how they work. Now, let's apply that knowledge in our third practical exercise. But before we dive in, let's briefly explore the theory behind the UV distortion shader feature. For this practical exercise, this cool shader feature will allow us to animate a static flame texture by distorting the UV coordinates of the plane where the texture will be applied. So, how does it work? We'll create the UV distortion shader feature by continuously changing the values of the default UVs, which range from 0 to 1. To do this, we'll use a scrolling gray noise texture. The noise texture has different shades of gray, where each shade represents a value between 0, black, and 1, white. These values will be added to the UVs. When we encounter white areas in the noise texture, their values will be added to the default UVs, causing them to move towards higher values both vertically and horizontally. This means that the corresponding parts of the flame texture will shift towards the top right direction. Essentially, these white areas create a displacement effect. Conversely, the entire black parts of the noise texture have no impact on the UVs, leaving them unchanged. This means that the areas of the flame texture corresponding to the black parts remain undistorted. Adding 0 to something won't change its initial value. As a result, with the scrolling noise applied to its UVs, the texture will appear to be dynamically shifting or morphing. Depending on the specific noise texture we use and its scale, we can achieve different visual outcomes. For example, we can use some sort of plasma noise to get a more liquid distortion effect, or use a regular pearl noise to get a smooth distortion of the flame. By using this UV distortion technique, we can quickly breathe life into our static flame texture without having to animate it by hand or render a particle simulation in another software like Houdini. And with that, we are done with the theory behind UVs and UV distortion. The second video about the UV distortion practical exercise will be coming soon on the channel, so stay tuned. And that's it, I hope you enjoyed this content. If you want to learn more about the Ablaze course, check out the description below. I wish you great health, folks, and I see you soon. Bye bye!